we're so glad that you can join us on this Friday evening here at Fountain of Life Ministry. As many of you know, but my name is Pastor Juan Hunter. I'm a pastor of Fountain of Life Ministry. So again, glad that you can join in with us for this night's Bible study. We do have a few words on tonight, and we're grateful that those have joined in with us on tonight here that's in this particular assembly. But we, of course, we do practice social distancing, and we encourage you all to do that as we are going through this particular period of COVID-19. And we're grateful to how things have been lifted to some degree, and we are asking and requesting for all to be safe during this time and use safety and precaution. So I just want to honor those that honor God, and that's real important during this time. We look around and we see individuals that are failing to do so, and such as a time as this, it should be a time that people are, they see the time in which we're living in, and it should provoke them to want to serve God and want to honor Him and live for Him. But I want to go before you in prayer, and then we'll get right into the Bible study. In the blessed name of Jesus, we honor you and we praise you. We thank you for being so gracious and kind to us all. You alone are deserving of all the praise. We're so grateful to you that how you have been with us, not only just today, but throughout the course of this week. You've blessed us over and over again and time again. You've been a God that's been truly faithful, committed to us, committed to your word, and we honor you for what you've done in times past, now, and even the times to come. You're wonderful and gracious and kind to your people. Open up their hearts so they receive a word and be doers of the word, not hearers only. In Jesus' name we pray. Bless. Use me how you see fit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless you. Again, give me a second. Forgive me, man. It's kind of hard in there. I don't want you to go. Fan going, but I want to talk about some things on tonight, if I may. We have talked about some things, and it wasn't last Friday, but it was the Friday before last. We talked about seeking God on the Friday before last, and I share with you that we picked that up about seeking God. And what comes to mind a lot of times when we think about seeking God, what comes to our mind is different things. And that is, we know that it's important for one way for us to seek God is through prayer. And another way is through fasting and through reading His word, through study, and a number of things, a way that we can seek God. But tonight I want to talk about, in that same vein of thought, still talk about seeking God, but we want to talk about seeking God through obedience to God. And because I think that's very important, because when it's all said and done, that God's calling for us to walk in accordance to His direction to us, walk in accordance to what His word states. And so we have to honor God in by walking in obedience unto God. We had talked previously about David, when we look at scripture, first chapter of Chronicles. We saw that David was encouraging his son to build the temple, as many of you know. But even when you look at that, we're gonna go back to it. But when you look at that, you'll find that there was other things that's within that scripture that we're gonna look at a little closer. But I want to, if I may, look at the book of Deuteronomy. For those of you who have your Bibles, and I should hope that you at home would have your Bibles as well, and you would follow along with me. But I want to look at that fourth chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. In fact, now I want to put emphasis on the fourth chapter. However, There's a few other books or chapters I look at as well, which would be the 11th chapter, which is found in 11, 1 through 17, 12th chapter of Deuteronomy as well, of 1 through 3. But I want to talk tonight and look at real closely, look at this fourth chapter. And looking at the fourth chapter, we want to put emphasis on a few verses there. If I may, we can begin in the 28th verse. 28th verse, fourth chapter, 28th verse. The word of God says, in the 28th verse, says, "And there ye shall serve gods, the works of men's hands, of wood and stone, which neither see nor hear, nor eat, nor smell. But if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, so thou shalt find him, if thou seek him with all thy heart, with all thy soul." And verse 30 says, "When thou art in tribulation, and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, if thou turn to the Lord thy God, and shall be obedient unto his voice." 31st, and I'll stop there. It says, "For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he swore unto them." When we look at the scripture, we find that it is a scripture where Moses, that he is talking to the children of Israel. Moses, he's talking to them, and he's putting emphasis. If you were to look at the beginning of this chapter, even in the first and in the second verse, the word of God says, "Now, therefore, hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto judgments which I teach you, for to do them, that ye may live, and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers giveth you." Second verse says, "Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish out from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you." You see here, Moses, he opens up in this chapter, and he's instructing the children of Israel and giving them exhortation, if you would, to walk in obedience to God. You even find in the 40th verse of that same chapter, and he says in the 40th verse, "Thou shalt keep therefore his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee this day, that it may go well with thee, with thy children after thee, and that thou mayest prolong thy days upon the earth, which the Lord thy God giveth thee forever." See, you find when you read the scripture, not just in the Old Testament, but the New Testament as well, that God had always instructed his people to obey him. It's never been a time where God had, that he really allowed or permitted one people to, or he wanted individuals to sin. It was always God's objective for people to walk in obedience to God. You find here, and you look at it even, and we'll go back to Deuteronomy, but you find even in the book of Genesis, and we'll go back, but third chapter, book of Genesis, is a story that all and many, especially children, that's been brought up in the Word of God, and it's a story regarding Adam and Eve that many are well familiar with. But you find here in the third chapter, the Word of God says, "Now the serpent was more," that's the first verse, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, May we eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden?" And 3 says, "But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it." You see, what God had given instructions, if you would, to Adam and Eve, and the instructions that they were given, all they had to do is walk in obedience to what God told them to do. But we find here that the serpent who had tricked and lied unto unto Eve. And the word says, and the serpent, for says, and the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. In fact, she did surely die. She died of what was most important, which is she died spiritually. And that's what God had ordained, and that we for us to, we are beings that we will live throughout eternity. But it's based on the life that we live that will determine what our outcome will be, who we will be with throughout eternity. And so that's why it's important for ones to know that God is calling for obedience unto him. He never changed from calling and requiring obedience from mankind to do what he said do. But the word says in the fifth verse, it says, for God doeth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods. And you have to look at that. You wouldn't be a capital G, because there's only one capital G, and that is God himself, who we know today, and he's revealed to us that it's Jesus. But when you look at the writing here, you see that there's a small G. There are other gods, but all the other gods are small G's. And it said, ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And this sixth verse 8, and when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And I'll add as well. But when we look at this, we'll find that Eve was tricked, she was lied to, but she walked in disobedience unto God. But it was not that God wasn't telling her he wasn't allowing her to walk in it, because it was God that wanted her to walk in obedience. Now, I'll go back to this, and I will talk a little bit more about that, and the things that, and how Eve, how she, the things that she looked at, she was allured, and the enemy, he used allurements. And even today, there are allurements that's being used, the lust of the eye, the flesh, and the pride of life. And I'll talk about that, because there are some things here in this fourth chapter that Moses brought out and that we still do today that God does not want us to do, that the children of Israel did then. But we find here, and for the sake of time, I want to cover as much as I can, but and just in, if you have your pencils, which you just write these scriptures down, just for the sake of time, I want to cover as much as I can, but I want you to write down Deuteronomy, the 12th chapter, because what it's about, it is about Moses, and Moses then as well, and it's multiple scriptures you can look at, but Moses, he's telling even then the children of Israel that they had to walk in obedience to God. And then the 12th chapter, 1 through 3, and then the 12th verse, 28th verse, and the 32nd verse. Look at that, not now, but look at that in your studies. But look at Deuteronomy as well, that 11th chapter, the 1st through the 17th verse. God is calling for obedience. He's calling for us today to walk in obedience. We look, and let's go back to the fourth, if we may. And I hope I'm not moving too fast for anyone. But we look in the fourth chapter, and we see in the 22nd verse, the word of God, it says here, Moses, he's talking, he said, but I must die in this land. Is what he's saying to the children of Israel. He said, I must die here. God will not allow me to see the promised land that you will see. In other words, I will not go over into the Jordan. But he says, I must not go over Jordan, but ye shall go over and possess that good land. But one thing that we find here that Moses is doing, he, from the first verse through the 13th verse, we find that Moses, he's he's encouraging them and that they would walk in obedience. But then we find even further from the 14th verse through the 40th verse that he's dissuading them, if you would, to walk against idolatry, to work against it, because God has he has ordained it even today, but it still happens today. But it's done in a different way, in a different form, in a different fashion, but it still exists. The same way that the enemy operated in the days of old, in the Old Testament, he still operates today. Yeah. He's still going to and fro, seeking to whom he may devour. He's going over the world trying to deceive the people, just as he deceived people then. In this particular time, the Word of God, it talks about that the people of God, Israel, that they had formed images, molten images and golden images and different types of images. And when we look at the 28th verse, if you would, because this is an important verse, it says, "And there ye shall serve." It's Moses, he's talking, he actually prophesied unto the children of Israel, telling them what their outcome would be. But he just didn't just leave them there and tell them what their outcome would be, but he gave them a sense of hope as well, as you read further down the scripture. But he prophesied about their outcome. He says that here in the 28th, he talks about how they would turn to idolatry, and they would turn away from God, that they would not continue to walk with God. And he said that he identifies in the gods in which, the small gods in which they would serve. And he identified them away. It says, "And there ye," in 28 says, "And there ye shall serve gods." He said, "The works of men's hands," not works of what God has done, but the works of what men has constructed and what men have made. And he said, "Wood made out of wood and made out of stone, which neither see," doesn't have the ability to be able to see. What he does is he's describing these little gods in their inabilities, but if you look at it closer, it really talks about God's ability.
Come on,
because the
come
same
on.
Way that he's talking about what those little gods cannot do, it doesn't say it, but in reading the scripture, we find that God has the ability to do everything that these little gods cannot do.
Yes.
So we find in there, "Ye shall serve gods, the work of men's hands." Look at that. The God that they were serving was gods that men had formulated themselves. But to serve the God that we serve,
yes,
he never was formed. He always was, and he always will be. He never had a beginning, nor does he have an ending. There was never anyone. The Word of God said, there's no other God beside him.
Yes,
he said,
yes.
If there was, then he said, "I know not of them." He's a God that knows all things. So, and he's a God that cannot lie. For if he would say, "I don't know him," then that means there's none other that exists. So Isaiah talks about that. But when we look at the Word, we find in looking at this Word, he said these gods were made with the works of men's hand and made of wood. And these are things, if you look at it, he said wood and stone. And in other words, they were made from the things that God had created. Did you hear me?
Yes,
made
yes.
from what God, from God's creation. Because God, he supersedes that. Everything that we see, everything that we even know of this life, it all came from God.
Yes,
God,
yes.
He made it all. The earth is the Lord, the fullness thereof, and all they that dwell therein, it all belongs to God. But God, he came before them because he created all that, even in the spiritual,
yes.
Even in the principalities and all the things in the high places. But we find that God, he created it all. And he even said, which neither these gods, I got to move, but he said, which neither these gods can see. See, we serve a God that the Word of God says that He sees all things. It's even the dark things God sees. And people that do hidden things, just everything is light unto God. You can do it in darkness, but the Word of God says He will bring it to light. Yeah. You can't hide nothing from God.
Yes.
He will reveal it in His own time. All the things that's done in the dark. I don't care where you take your bed, where you make it at. God will see it. God is there. The Word of God, when we see this, He goes on to say in this 28, He said, with neither see, the all-seeing God He is. He said, nor do they have the ability to hear. And look at this, so that you will know this without a shadow of a doubt, that God, that even with His people, what God does for His people, He is attentive to the cries of His people.
Yes.
You've got something special when you walk with God.
Oh, glory.
Because God, He's attentive to your cry. He sees where you are and all the things that you're going through. And He's here only but to help you and to be able to see you through. But He said, nor does He eat. When we look at the Word of God, we know that God, He doesn't need to eat.
Yeah, take your time.
We know God doesn't need to eat. In fact, it's God that provides the food that His creation needs to eat. And we do find that God did eat at one time by way of Jesus when He came and He ate with His disciples after He had came back, if you would, upon this earth and had revealed to His disciples that He was yet alive. But the Word of God said that He did eat. But we must know that God does not need to eat.
Yes, yes.
In fact, He doesn't need to eat because He's the great, He's the provider. And,
yeah.
And in fact, all things come from God. He's the sustainer.
Yes,
he's the one that gives the life and everything else. In fact, the Word of God tells us that He is the bread of life.
Yes,
so we eat from God.
Yes,
God doesn't need to provide anything for Himself to eat.
Teach.
Because God provides everything for mankind to eat from Him.
Yes.
But the Word of God, when we look at the Word of God, He said they don't even have the ability to smell. And I don't want to put a lot of emphasis on this, but I like this about God, that those that was made, those gods that was made with hands, He said, but the God of God, the only wise God, the only one God, he has a smell. He has a sense of smell, if you would. But what He smells, He smells the things that are sweet, the things that are righteous, the things that are holy, the life that a person lives that is good unto God. That's what God smells, and in fact, it is sweet to His nostril.
Yeah,
and it's not good to His nostril when it's bad, when it's evil, then it's a stench unto God. But we live a life that God will, that our life, that it goes up unto God, that it is a sweet smelling savor. Look at God. So He looks at our life, and He likes the scent and the fragrance that we give off unto Him. God is awesome and all that. So the God that we serve does smell. But what He smells, then He smells the life of one that is holy,
yes,
the one that is righteous, the one that is godly, and the one that lives for Him. But let me move quickly, if I may, because the 28th verse, let me tell you this, because when you look at the 27th verse, what it is truly telling us in this, in our 27th, but the 28th verse, it talks about the idolatry that mankind would, how they would serve other gods, if you would. But you must know the enemy, he has not changed what he does. He has not changed the things that in him trying to trick and trying to fool the people of God and even this world, if you would, because he wants to deceive. Idolatry still exists today, but there it's called a modern day idolatry. See, idolatry, what it means is anything that's put before God,
help
or anything that's put above
help
God,
us.
Or anything that's exalted above God or anything you look at it. That when you put something before God or above God or beyond God, you must know that nothing is above, before, right, or beyond. So God, he says, I'm a jealous God. Now, now he doesn't have the jealousy that you and I have. Reason why he doesn't have the jealousy that you and I have, because God owns everything.
Yes, sir.
He has ownership. Yeah. Because he has the ownership, that he has the right to have a godly jealousy, because it all belongs to him. And then the jealousy that you and I have, we don't own nothing. So we can't be jealous about anything that we do not own.
All right.
So God says, I'm jealous because all this is mine. Look at God. But we find when we look at the word of God, we find that there is a modern day idolatry. Whether you realize it or not, but even the church got to watch out because even today they're practicing a modern day idolatry. They're putting things above God. They're putting things first and not putting God first. And they think it's going to be all right, but it's not going to be all right. The enemy just trying to trick them. Because they got to realize that God is always calling, hallelujah, for you to put him first and for you to seek him, but for you to seek him through obedience.
Yes, yes.
He wants you to seek him through obedience, doing the things that God, that he tells you to do, to walk according to God's word, if you would. But we, today, we have formulated another type of altar, if you would. It's an altar of selfishness. It's an altar of self, if you would, where we have become gods ourselves. We are similar to Eve, because the same thing that the enemy had told Eve about, that you will be come like God, then folk today are really becoming like God, because what they do is they think they can take care of themselves. They think they know better than God. They think they know how to do this above God. They will not trust God and depend on what God says within his word. They think they can do it on their own, but they have lost sight on the fact that they don't think, they can't even see, they even understand, hallelujah, what's even in front of them. How can they even understand what is beyond even what's in front of them? In fact, let me make this a little bit clearer to you. We don't have that type of hallelujah sight, if you would, or foresight, hallelujah, or even sight that we can see beyond. Hallelujah. I look around at those that are in my midst, and there's no way for me to understand the things that I'm looking at in front of me. How can I know what's beyond? Hallelujah. What's in the other room? Even at that, how can I know what's ahead when I walk out the door? Right. What's facing me when I get home? How will I know the situation that is arising and what's going to happen within that situation? Woo. I've got to trust a God that knows.
Yeah.
Everything in my home. but I gotta pray and I gotta seek and I gotta ask God, Lord, what is you want me to do? Even in this little church, if you would, what would you have me to do? Arm myself, direct me, if you would, Lord. I ain't gotta like get to know what's happening on the south end of town and the west end of town. How do you let alone within the body of God? Because I only serve God. I serve God and just I am a member of the body of Christ. And I don't know anyone that has the ability to know what the whole body is doing. But let me tell you, if I may, but we have come to a point where we want to know, hallelujah, where we want to exalt ourselves, if you would. But we find that there are altars of self. And you must know if there is an altar of self, then and there is an altar of your flesh. And God has not ordained it ever for his people to operate within self.
That's right.
Or to operate within the flesh, if you would.
Yes.
You can look at the book of Galatians, turn to it, if you would.
Yes, Jesus, be Lord.
Look at the book of Galatians, one that many of you, in the fifth chapter, Galatians, it says, and it talks about two particular things in these particular verses, but it talks about the work of the flesh and the works of the spirit. But when you look at the works of the flesh, it identifies this work. And when it identifies, it says, even, you can look at 16, because he gives us instructions on how we should walk in the Spirit. God has ordained for us to be led by his Spirit. But he says in 16, he said, this I say then of the flesh. And he says, and see, you must know that anything that is of the flesh is of this world. And the God of this world is ruled by Satan. This world is Satan's domain.
That's right.
It's not God's domain. God has another domain, and that is within the spiritual realm that you have to be born in. And the thing about this, you have to operate in that spiritual realm and be led by God himself, the Spirit of God. So what happens is you see there's operations of the flesh, and then there's operations of God's Spirit that operates in you that we are to be led by. But then you see here that within this world of the flesh, in this worldly realm that Satan that he controls, we find it here and it identifies those particular things. He says, again in 16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I like that because it tells you if you're going in one direction,
that's right,
then you can't go in the other direction. In other words, if you walk in God in the Spirit, there's no way that you can walk in the flesh. Uh-huh. Because there are two opposite directions that one would go in. And then the Word of God even tells us in the book of Romans that the two, they war against one another. But 17 said, for the flesh lusted against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. 18 says, but if, I'm reading in the fifth chapter, Galatians 18, but if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. 19 says, now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these. And he identifies them. And when he identifies them, he says, idolatry, fornication, mm-hmm, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, variances, immolation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envy, murders, and the list goes on. He said, drunkenness, reveling and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So what it tells us, this individual or people that walk in this manner, that practice these particular things, they are not of God. They are of another kingdom, and that is of this worldly kingdom, but not of the spiritual kingdom that God has ordained for us to walk in. And you got to know that, and that 22 goes on and it identifies the fruit of the Spirit. And it tells that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. I'm talking as fast as I can to cover as much as I can. But meekness, temperance, he said, against such there is no law. God has ordained for us to walk in the fruit of the Spirit.
Yes.
And to walk in obedience to the Spirit. The Spirit of God would direct us in a manner that directs us in everything that I just read to you regarding the fruit of the Spirit. The opposite of that is an operation in a realm of the world. And God has taken us out of that. Anyone that operates in that realm operates in a realm of disobedience.
Mercy.
You cannot walk in that realm and practice these particular things and call yourself a child of God, and you're walking in disobedience. John talks about it. John said that we are children of obedience.
That's right.
Children of light. We do what God tells us to do. We follow what God. If you want to see God, obey what God says.
That's right.
You cannot see God and disobey God and call yourself seeking God.
That's right.
So let me help somebody here, if I may. Whatever God has directed you and how he has directed you, where you are right now, obey what God has instructed you to do right now.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, right now. And there are folk that have gotten themselves in trouble, and God has to help them because the trouble that they've gotten themselves in. Let me turn back. I'm going to come back, if I may. But even when we look at the 30th chapter of the book of Deuteronomy, he says, let me read 29 if I may, and then 30. It says, but if from thence, is what I like. He said, because he's already prophesied it unto them, and already told them the outcome of what would happen to them, but here's the hope that I told you about earlier. That God had prophesied unto Moses, and that he tells the people of God. He says, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord. In other words, I'm glad God is like that. He gives us hope. Even when you've made the mistakes that you made, God, he still gives you hope. Even from the point of where you are now. Moses said, from the point, even from turning your back on God, worshiping other small gods. He said, even from that point, if you would, he says, thou shalt seek the Lord thy God. Look at the hope that God gives us. He didn't leave. He told Moses, I'm not going to leave them there because I'm a God of mercy, and I want to help them. And you must know today that God won't leave you where you are. But one thing you must know, and you can even start right now, start to seek God.
Yes.
How do you seek God? Through obedience unto
God.
That's right. Through obedience. He said, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him. Look at that. Look at that. I'm so grateful that God wants to be found. Look at that.
Ooh,
he wants to be found. But something's left up to us that we must be in pursuit of God. The word of God tells us, ask, knock, and seek. That's in pursuit
That's right.
of God.
That's
God
right.
does pursue us. And
yes,
in other words,
yes.
He not only loves pursuers, but there's promises to the pursuers.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. That he will be found. He said, you're going to find me if you seek me. And then the one word said, if you seek me early, look at God, look at God. But I want to cover this because the time is getting away from me. But he said, thou shalt find him if thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. See, I got to get through this, but I find that one of the biggest issues is folk, they call themselves seeking God, but they will not seek God with their all.
Yes, yes.
And that's what God, he not only wanted them to seek him, but them to be obedient to him, but he says with their all. And there's a word in Matthew 15 and 8, the word of God, it talks about how folk, they worship God with their lips, with their mouth, but their heart.
My God.
It's far from him.
Help us.
And see, God is calling for folk to worship him with their, not partial heart, but whole heart. There's another word that says a double-minded person is unstable. And if you wonder why you're going through what you're going through, you're unstable. Jesus. Because you're double-minded. You can't serve two gods.
That's right.
You can't serve Satan and serve God, Satan, little G, and serve big G, God, Jesus, as well. You can't serve the two. The word says you are hate one, despise the other, or love one, despise the other. You can't love the enemy and love God too.
That's right.
In fact, there's a word that says, if you love this world, then you are enemy of God.
That's right.
So you can't love these things in the world and think that you are God. God is your closest friend. We sing these songs about how God is my friend and I love God and he's the best thing. But if you really love God, the word of God says, you will keep my
commandments.
If you really love him.
That's right.
See, signs of you really loving God is signs of you being obedient unto God. You know when a person loves God because they walk in obedience. So if you want to start, I got to help somebody real briefly because I'm going to take about 10 minutes and I'll close. If you want to rise from the position of where you are and you want to get closer to God, then start doing what God says do.
That's right.
We got so many folk that go to church and so many people, they got these televised pastors and they get sermons and they got pastors all the way in Texas and they live in Louisville. That person ain't your pastor.
That's right.
Because they don't know nothing about you and you not even held accountable in any kind of way. You got to know that this day is a day of accountability. Yes. Because if you are accountable today, then you ain't got to worry about, oh, hallelujah, or being called up out of here in the rapture, because you got to know that today within the church, hallelujah, judgment begins today. That's within it. The church.
That's it.
And if you let God judge you through his spirit today, you ain't got to worry about where your destination is going to be.
Jesus.
Because the word of God says judgment begins with the house of God, the church. It begins with you right now today. When God says get it right, get it right.
Amen.
When God says do this, do that. Whatever he tells you to do, walk in obedience unto God, because you will be held accountable to what God's telling you. And you can't say that God did not tell you.
Jesus.
You can't say he didn't tell you. I believe, and I got to hurry, but I believe that when God, on the judgment day, and you standing before God, you can't say, I didn't know, because you got to know it's going to be like a court. It
all
is.
Right. All right.
And there's going to be some witnesses.
Yes, sir.
Ain't no thing about time you ain't going to worry about, because you're in eternity. So he going to say, but I didn't know. He said, on December the 12th, 1999, I sent Brother Smith to you, and Brother Smith told you this, and Brother Smith told you that about what you needed to do to be right with me. And I believe that Brother Smith will stand up and be able to come, Brother Smith, if you would, and testify to the fact of what you told him.
Paint the picture.
Yes, yes, yes. That's what will happen. Look at the word of God, because the word of God says that the righteous, that the church will judge this world.
Yeah.
And that's why he tells us we should be the judge. Don't take these spiritual matters, if you would, between the church. We should be the judge matters within ourselves. Don't go to a natural judge, but judge matters within ourselves. What more? If we can judge, if we're going to be the judge of the world, you got to look at that up in Scripture. If we're going to judge the world, why couldn't we be the judge these type of matters?
Jesus.
You look at that. You must know without a shadow of a doubt what God is calling for. I'm going to let you go if I may. But you'll find that God, that he no longer is living, is allowing us to live in such a way that we walk in disobedience, but that we walk in obedience unto God. Someone turn real briefly, if you would, to the book of Ephesians 2 and 3. The word, if you have it, two and three. Actually, it's one through three. And the word of God is talking about the state, the sinful state of man. It talks about being saved by grace, but yet created unto good works. But just reading one through three, it says, and you had he quickened who were dead. Now look at that. He said, you had passed him, had he quickened who were dead. And not that you are right now walking in those things that he's brought. He has spiritually resurrected your life from the old man to the new man. And now he says, wherein, in verse 2, in time past he walked. E.D. He walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Talking about Satan. You used to walk this way, but no longer do you walk this way. You used to walk in disobedience, child of God. You no longer walk in disobedience. He says here, according to the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, those folk that are walking after the world's standards and operating in the flesh, and the things I read to you in the fifth chapter of the book of Galatians, those are children of disobedience who operate in that order, in that form. But he says, not so. You don't operate like that no more. That was in time past. And in other words, we used to be like that. We're not like that no more. And even if you're like that, God, and blood is running warm in your veins, yeah, you got the opportunity for God to change you.
Yes.
For him to display his mercy on you. That's what he told them in the fourth chapter. Hallelujah. Don't turn. Just I'll read it to you if I will, because I want to finish that. But that's what he told Moses. He said, for the Lord that God is a merciful God. You got to know that God is merciful.
Yes.
And his objective is for you to be saved. So he offers unto you even today, he offers mercy. Third verse says, in the Ephesians, in the second chapter, third verse, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past. When it talks about conversation, it's not the words that coming out of your mouth.
That's right.
It's talking about the lifestyle that you used to live.
That's right. That's right.
It's not talking about what it, when it says conversation, it's not talking about verbally what your verbal expression, but it's talking about your lifestyle. It's talking about your conduct and your behavior.
That's right.
Is what it is referring to. So it says, among whom also we all had our lifestyle and conduct in times past in the lust of our flesh.
Yeah.
But we are not like that anymore. We don't operate in the flesh anymore. And even when things happen in our life where we find ourselves succumbing to anything that's pertaining to the flesh, God will forgive you.
Yes, he will.
But you got to ask for forgiveness.
That's right.
And you got to walk after the things that are righteous and the things that are holy before God. And he says, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and not and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. We used to be the children of wrath. We used to be the children of disobedience,
yeah,
but not anymore.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you got to ask and say, Lord, help me, because I don't want to be that way anymore.
That's right.
Titus, he talks about it in my clothes, in Titus 3:3, You can get that if you would, but I want to go, I want to, I don't have time to really go through it, but Titus 3:3, it talks about being enslaved to various lusts and various pleasures, if you would. Because what happens when you operate in the flesh, then there's things within you, within the flesh, that it desires. And a lot of times people are succumbing to their desires.
That's right.
Things that they want, things that they like, they are succumbing. In fact, Timothy talks about it. I got to turn to that in Timothy. I have to in the second chapter. But you look at that in your leisure in Titus 3:3. But we don't do that anymore. But you look in 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 6. The word of God says, he talks about the wickedness in the last day he identifies, but he says, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. Mm-hmm. He said, they'll be covetous, boasters, proud. Look at that. Blasphemer. Look at that. Disobedience of parents. Unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, false as traitors, high-headed, high-minded, lovers of, somebody help me with that.
Pleasures.
Lovers of.
Pleasures.
Pleasures. Look at that, more than lovers of God. And that's what we find today, that people are, and they are for more of love of pleasures than more love for the things of God.
That's right.
And he says in the fifth verse, in the fifth, the last one I read, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, he says, from such turn away. There's a lot of things that we're going to have to turn away from. Because things that look good is not always good for you.
You're right, Pastor.
Because your flesh, it'll be crying out. Just because it look good, you'll go after it. There's a scripture in 2 Samuel 11, 2 through 4. You find out David. He was a perfect example. He looked out. He was on his terrace or patio or whatever you want to call it. But he steps out only to see a beautiful lady, and when he went to see, when he stepped out to see this beautiful lady, the word of God, it tells us, if you give me just a few seconds, if you would. It said, and it came to pass in the evening time, that David rose from his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman washing herself. And the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman. And one said, is not this Sheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah, the Hittite? And David went, and David sent messengers and took her. And she came in unto him, and he lay with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness. And she returned into her house. The word of God says, and the woman conceived, but we find that she had a child through what David lusted after. But it was not good for David.
That's right.
Looked good, but wasn't good. In fact, and that's one thing that we must learn today, all the things that look good is not good for us and not good for us. Eve, as I already shared with you, it looked good. And if you go back and look at that and things that she identified, look at what she identified. And because of her flesh and her walking in disobedience to God, the world, and she even persuaded Adam, we ended up in the state that we're in. But I thank God that there is a second Adam.
Glory.
His name is Jesus.
Yes.
There's a second Adam. There's a second man. And what this second man, what Adam brought was darkness and damnation to this world. But what the second man, the second Adam did, he brought life to this world. And that more abundantly. And his name is Jesus. And the church walks in what God has provided for us, and we are seeking him through obedience, through doing what God directs and orders us to do. Because all that we do, we must be pleasing unto God. God bless you. I got other things to share with you, but just for the sake of time, I'm going to bring it to a close. And again, I'm glad that you joined in with us on this Friday evening. And as always, I ask you to continue to support us in this ministry, Family Life Ministry, by cash out, by PayPal, through the mail, you can send it through 1234 South Florida Street, of course, Louisville, Kentucky. 4203 is the zip code. So I just want you to know that. And
Zell.
Did I say? I always forget Zell. Maybe I'll write those down. But with that, I want you to support us if you would. God bless you. We appreciate you. We've got a plan for you. And more than anything, we want you saved.
Amen.
We want you saved.
Amen.
All that's been said and done, I think God's purpose is for folk to be saved. Amen. Everything he's doing is purpose for people to be saved. In the name of Jesus, Lord, all those that heard your word, I'm asking you to direct them. And for those that are children of disobedience, to walk and to become children of obedience, children of light and not of darkness. So all that you put on the heart of men, even now that it was under the sound of my voice, Father, I'm asking you to deal with their heart. And let them be doers of your word and not hearers only. Help them, even now, that they'll be righteous and holy and pleasing unto you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. We wish you Godspeed. God bless you.